Friends, I am very happy to introduce to you Swami Smaranandaji, the General Secretary of the Ramakrishna Math and Mission. The Swami is a senior monk and a trustee, and he is the executive head of the order. Swami joined the Ramakrishna Order in 1952 in Bombay. Then he came to Advaita Ashrama, which was started by Swami Vivekananda in 1958, June. And I came to St. Advaita Ashrama 1st December 1958. And I lived with Swami from 1958 to 1971, when I came to Hollywood. Of course, 2 years I stayed in Balloon Mutt in the training center. So I lived with him for many years. Then Swami left Advaita Ashrama in 1976 and went to Ramakrishna Mission Sharada Pith, a big educational institution, as a secretary. Then he became one of the trustees of the Ramakrishna Order. Then again he went to Madras for 3.5 years as a president. Then he came to Balloon Mutt, became assistant secretary. Then in 1997 he became the general secretary. That position is a very difficult position. He had to manage 1,300 monks, 139 centers. One day I remember when Swami Gumbhirananda was the general secretary, he was asking me, how many problems do you have? I said, I don't have, by the Master Lord's grace, I don't have any personal problem. But as a center, you know, when you are head of a center, you have to face various problems. So very few devotees' problem or some center's problem. Then I asked, how many problems do you have? He said, every day I open my mail and I find 30 to 35 problems. Then I asked him, how do you solve? I don't solve. Master solves everything. So when we are going today, we went to see the cathedral. On the way back, I was telling the Swami, he said, not only 30, 35, I get more problems now. Anyhow, Swami, I remember when he was a city editor of the Prabuddha Bharata, he was a very good writer. His English was very good. And he wrote some articles. I used to read his articles. He's a good speaker and very scholarly monk. He knows scriptures very well. Anyhow, just now I was telling him that we've seen the bulletin of other centers. I selected the topic, the ideals of the Ramakrishna Order. So he will speak on that topic tonight because it has been announced. Otherwise, I would ask him to speak on the Upanishads. That is his favorite subject. Anyhow, he is the right person to speak about the ideals of the Ramakrishna Order, Swami Smaranandaji. Thank you.
Om Stapakaya cha dharmasya sarva dharma swarupine avatar varishtaya Sri Ramakrishnaya te namaha. Dear friends, I am very happy to be with you all this evening. I arrived from Chicago yesterday evening. And for the last 1 month, I have been traveling around in the United States. I have a long itinerary before me. I landed in Los Angeles on my way to San Francisco on April 12th. I came via Japan. And after 3 days in San Francisco, I went to Seattle, then Vancouver, BC, then Portland, then Toronto, then Chicago, and I am here today. So still, a good amount of traveling is there. By the end of June, I am supposed to go back to India. So the subject that has been announced are the ideals of the Ramakrishna order. When we talk about the ideals of the Ramakrishna order, we have to remember that they have been derived directly from Sri Ramakrishna himself. And his chief disciples, Swami Vivekananda, who started the Ramakrishna mission, named the mutt or the monastery also as Ramakrishna mutt. It's a twin organization with, on the one hand, the Ramakrishna mutt, which is meant for looking after the welfare of the monks, training of the novices, and looking after the cult and ecclesiastical affairs, temple, worship, and other cultural and religious activities. It was originally meant to be that only, but as time went on, Ramakrishna Math also has been doing in many parts of India various social service activities. And when Swami Vivekananda returned to India in 1897 from the West, he started the Ramakrishna Mission, meant to serve the people in all possible ways. He placed before the order a twin ideal, which he called in Sanskrit the Atmanu Mokshartam Jagati Hitaya Cha, for one's own liberation and for the welfare of all. And you know, immediately after Sri Ramakrishna's passing away, in 1886, the few young people who were to form the monastic order, who had been directly or indirectly told by the master that they would have to lead a monastic life, there were about 11 of them at that time, and a few more came in later, and they assembled together in a small, old, dilapidated building on the bank of the Ganga on its eastern bank. And that is how the Ramakrishna order started. They had hardly anything to eat. They had to be satisfied with a little rice, a little salt, and some greens. And there were, many of them were moving about in various, through India, like the traditional monks, who go about begging their food, walk from place to place, visit various pilgrim centers. That is the sort of austerity usually the Hindu monks do. And that is what they were doing at that time. But Swami Vivekananda, who traveled all over India for a few years and then came to the United States in 1893, and appeared before the Parliament of Religions, where he made his mark. And that was perhaps the first time in history, a Hindu monk going abroad to bring the teachings of the Vedanta to the world at large. That is how it all started. But at the base of it, was the ideals that had been placed before the world by Sri Ramakrishna through his spiritual experiences, through his realizations. And these ideals which he placed before the world were universal in character. And these are the motivating force for the whole Ramakrishna order. And therefore, let us have a little look at it. What are these ideals? How he indicated the great truths which is preached through various religions, not only Hinduism, but Christianity and Islam. And you know, for the first 12 years in Dakshineshwar Kali temple, when he was a young man, Sri Ramakrishna practiced various spiritual disciplines one after the other. And after he had the vision of Mother Kali, later on he followed it up by various other spiritual practices prescribed by various sects of Hinduism, the Vaishnava sects, the tantric sects, and so on. And finally the Advaita Vedanta, for which he was guided by one great monk called Totapuri. And then later on he also practiced for a few days the Islamic way of religious spiritual practice. Then suddenly one day when he had gone to a devotee's house nearby, he saw the picture of Madonna and the child. I think it is Raphael. This painting, it was a copy perhaps. Now it is in our San Francisco Center. It's a wonderful picture. Looking at it, immediately I had a vision of Mary and Jesus. And he was in that totally unaware of all his surroundings for 3 days. All these experiences, I have very briefly, within 3-4 minutes, I mentioned it. It is a long story. It's a long odyssey, which would take a long time to describe. But because our subject is a little different, I just wanted to touch upon it. But what did he indicate? First, he proved to the world that religion and God are true. Just let us remember, in the 19th century, later part of the 19th century, religion was about to be wiped out from the face of the earth. That is what the scientific advances, scientific progress, made people think that we can do without religion. So Sri Ramakrishna's assertion that God and religion are true came at a time in world history when religion was about to be thrown overboard. And that was a great thing. But he didn't stop at that. When Narendranath, the young man, who became later on Swami Vivekananda, when he approached him for the first time, "Sir, have you seen God?" He immediately, the reply came, "Yes, I have seen God and I can show him to you. I can make you also realize God. It is possible." So it is not just wild imagination, but it is something that can be experienced, provided you pay the price for it, provided you do what is necessary. If you have to do something in the world, if you have to achieve certain things in the world, we do work very hard for it in the externally, but we have to work inwardly for this realization, which Ramakrishna had done in a very big way, perhaps unique in the history of the world. I say this because if you look at the history of the world, the mystics and saints of not only India but of the Christendom, great mystics, you will find that they are all satisfied. They were all satisfied the moment they achieved their goal through a particular path. But in the case of Sri Ramakrishna, it was not so. Once he had the vision of Mother Kali, he was not satisfied with that alone. He wanted to travel by other paths prescribed by various religion and various sects in Hinduism. And finally, he reached the goal by every one of them and declared that as many religions, so many paths. In Bengali, he said, "Jatamot Tatapath." So all these religious doctrines, all these religious paths which are prescribed by various sects of Hinduism or in other religions, particularly the world religions of Christianity and Islam, every one of them is true, but quarreling and fighting in the name of religion is, to say the least, is that it is stupidity. So the person who wants to progress spiritually, if he hates people belonging to other religions or other sects, that would, he can't progress in spiritual life. So this was a great message. It was there in India earlier, even in the Vedic age. There is the saying, ekam sat vibra vipra bahudha vadanti. Truth is one, sages call it by various names. This idea you find in the Gita and elsewhere, but they are in the books. But to practice them and prove them, and to a modern world where reason and science had the upper hand, and even now they have the upper hand. So he proved to the world that religion is true, God is true, God can be realized, and all paths leading to, or all paths lead to the same goal. Then, these are, again, he also proved to the world that service to man is service to God. One day, people were in his, when he was in Dakshineshwar Kali temple, and there were so many devotees assembled. Somebody mentioned about compassion, showing compassion to others. He exclaimed, "What? Compassion? Who are you to show compassion to anybody? Are you Lord God? You will go show compassion? Then are we not to show compassion?" No, I don't mean that. What I mean is that not compassion, but service. Understand that all people, all human beings, are a manifestation of that God, of the Supreme God. And serve them as such, serve the people. Service to man is service to God. This idea is also not entirely new. But again, it had to be given a practical shape as time went on. When Swami Vivekananda, as a young man, was present on that occasion, when he heard it, he said, "Today I have heard a great truth. If I get an opportunity, I will certainly preach this all over the world." So that is one more thing. And above all, Sri Ramakrishna's renunciation. It's a difficult word. The word in Sanskrit is tyaga. And difficult to preach renunciation. Even 100 years back, when Swami Vivekananda was going about preaching Vedanta in the United States, he said it is very difficult to talk on renunciation in this country, because this country gives the topmost importance to welfare in the world, progress in the world. And renunciation will not be appreciated here. But yet, to modern man, as time goes on, you will find renunciation is becoming more and more important. In a consumerist society, that renunciation of some kind will be necessary if you have to find peace and think of the welfare of the world. This is not my opinion, it is the opinion of some of the great thinkers of the West, like Arnold Toynbee. I don't have the quotation here, and moreover, there is no time to go into it now. So here is another renunciation. I remember an incident in the Holy Mother Sharada Devi's life, where some of her disciples were discussing among themselves what is the greatest contribution of Sri Ramakrishna. They were saying that the harmony of religions is his greatest contribution. The Holy Mother was hearing it quietly and said, "Put in, what are you talking about, the harmony of religions? His greatest contribution is the renunciation that he practiced. He could not touch money. He could not think of any woman as anything less than an embodiment of the Divine Mother. And he would say always that man wants to satisfy his desire for lust and lucre. It is all, the whole of life for which man tries to live, these are the only two things." But this is not said for the first time. Again, you will find it in these Hindu scriptures, Vedantic scriptures, and in other religions also. In fact, though everybody wants physical enjoyment, everybody wants to be rich, but they do appreciate people who are men of renunciation, who can give up selfish desires. Some years back, I was talking to one of our Swamis, an American Swami, who had gone to India. And he told me, Swami, don't think that only in India people appreciate renunciation. It is also true, austerity and renunciation is appreciated in the United States also. Because that is, though man is selfish, he understands and respects selflessness. Renunciation is selflessness. So everybody need not become a monk, but everybody has to be selfless if he has to progress spiritually. So these are the, broadly speaking, some of the ideals that are before the Ramakrishna order. And with the ideal that was placed before us by Swami Vivekananda, its leader, who founded this twin organization of Ramakrishna Math and Ramakrishna Mission. Incidentally, I can tell you that the trustees of the Ramakrishna Math form the governing body of the Ramakrishna Mission, the same people. So both are in essence the same organization. They both come under the Ramakrishna order. And this Swami Vivekananda placed before them that Atmano Mokshartam Jagadhitaya Che, for one's own liberation and for the welfare of the whole world. So his monastic brotherhood that got formed during the lifetime, during the last days of Sri Ramakrishna, and then later on strengthened by Swami Vivekananda. And when he came to America, he understood that Vedanta has a world mission. It has something, India has something to give to the world. India has many things to learn from others, particularly from the West, in the field of science, technology, and economic progress. But you should remember that at that time, India was not free. Politically, India was not free, so whatever they wanted to do, they could not do. But still, Swami Vivekananda understood that India must have economic prosperity. India should work for the betterment of science and technology. These things they have to learn from the West, but at the same time, there is a perennial philosophy, the perennial philosophy of Vedanta, which can give peace to modern man, which can make his life meaningful. That is also necessary, that India should be able to give to the world. Now you may say, all right, subject being Ramakrishna order, the ideals of the Ramakrishna order, how are you translating this ideal into practice? It's a very pertinent question you can raise. Many have this idea that Swami Vivekananda started this welfare organization and welfare activities after returning from the West. He had taken these ideas from the Christians, from Christianity. This has been written by many people. To some extent, that is true, but not totally. These ideas were there since ancient times in India, but there was no proper organization. That is why Swami Vivekananda wanted an organization. And therefore he wanted that this idea of service to mankind should be worked out through the Ramakrishna Mission. And in 1897 itself, one of his brother disciples plunged into famine relief in one of the northern districts of Bengal. Not only that, in other parts of India also, in a small way, the sort of relief activities in times of distress were started even at that time, in 1897, when they had nothing to. It was just started by 25 cents. In those days it was called 4 NS. And then even hospitals were, dispensaries were started at that time in 1900. Now these activities have grown to big proportions. I'll come to that later. So mankind needs to be served on three levels. And when we talk of service to people, some people, particularly in the West, who are interested in meditation, those who want to all right, this service, etc., we know. What are you doing about meditation? What are you doing about spiritual progress? You should not divide life into so many compartments. You'll have to take a whole view of it, holistic view of it. When you look at that like this, the spiritual disciplines are necessary, and at the same time, service to others also should go hand in hand. Now, how to do that is the question. Man lives on three levels: the instinct, physical, mental, and spiritual. The spiritual is very often ignored. They think it is, what is the spiritual? When Swami Vivekananda spoke on Jesus Christ in one of his famous lectures, most probably in the West Coast, Christ the Messenger, he says he was all spirit, he was not a body. He was all spirit. The innermost essence of every human being is the spirit, not the body, not even the mind. So mankind lives on three levels: the physical, mental, and spiritual. So service has to be done on these three levels. The physical level, where physical help in a poor country like India, where hospitals, where poor people are treated almost free, or clinics, mobile dispensaries, where in the interior villages, countryside, where mobile medical vans go. This is all on the physical level. And there are relief activities in a big way nowadays. It is being conducted. As an example, I can mention, last year when there was a terrible cyclonic storm and tides as high as 20 feet came from the sea and inundated vast areas of the state of Orissa in eastern India, that lot of damages, because houses, people were living, it is a tropical country, people were living in mud houses with some hay roofs. So everything was raised to the ground by the tide that came and the storm. So a lot of relief agencies entered the picture, we also. So primary relief amounting to 13 million rupees was done, in help was given in various ways, food materials, clothing, vessels, to 10,000 families. And now we have taken up a project for rebuilding a village completely. In the same place where their mud huts were there, build a cyclone-proof houses, then drinking water facilities, sanitation, and all, so on. That would also cost about 33 million rupees. Money is coming, and money will come, I think, more. So this is now our relief work in such situations. I've taken a big stride forward. The large proportions it has taken, assumed. Right now, after I left, there has been a terrible drought in Western India. Already relief operations have been started. And many other voluntary organizations are there nowadays which do it. But mind you, all these ideas of service to people, it all started with the Ramakrishna Mission, which Swami Vivekananda founded in 1897. Now this idea is gradually spreading to various other people belonging to other denominations in Hinduism, and even social service organizations are coming up in a big way in India. So this is an idea. Any movement, even great revolutions, have started with an idea and an ideal. And here, some of the great ideals which motivate human life have been placed before us by Sri Ramakrishna. That is how these things started happening. In mental, we have many educational institutions. I think we have nearly 140,000 students study, boys and girls study in various educational institutions run by the Ramakrishna Mission. many places there. Schools, adult education schools, non-formal education schools, then the colleges, then polytechnics and industrial training centers, all these are being run by the monks with the help of course, householders and also employees. And cultural work, libraries, there are some in Calcutta perhaps, the second biggest and the best library is run by us in Calcutta, and many other libraries. Then the third aspect, spiritual aspect. In the West, essentially, we are bringing that aspect of Vedanta which is necessary for the fulfillment of human life, that is how we feel about it. And even in India, the temples and the worships and giving classes and lectures regularly, explaining the scriptures in a modern way, in the light of the teachings of Ramakrishna, Vivekananda and Mother Sarada Devi. All these are going on simultaneously. So all these on these three levels, serving human beings, serving men and women in on these three levels, physical, mental and spiritual. That is what the Ramakrishna Mission is doing. And this is considered also as a spiritual practice. Spiritual practice does not mean only meditation or just confining yourself to the chapel. It is something more than that. It has to be our whole life has to develop in a spiritual way. As Swami Vivekananda put it, that have an ideal in life and let your whole life be transformed in, suffused with that ideal. Then only it becomes meaningful. So this is one of the methods. Along with that, worship, meditation, studies. You may say, oh, Ramakrishna never cared for any study. It was not necessary for him. But for us it is necessary. Because we have to study. We have to study the scriptures. We have to understand them. We have to discriminate. And then find out what is suitable for us. Only when it becomes a conviction and faith becomes deep, then only one can begin to start traveling on the spiritual path. It is true of anything else also. If a person has to study science, he has to accept certain fundamental maxims as true. He has to begin with faith in those maxims. Similarly, in spiritual life also, you need some fundamental ideas about which one is convinced. Today, the modern man's predicament is this, that he is looking for some certainty, some abiding values in the midst of all these ephemeral things. Is there anything that is abiding, that is permanent? Can we be certain about something or not? So in quest of certainty, that is what is happening to me. So in the midst of that, the Vedantic ideal and the Ramakrishna order is trying to place before humanity at large. The method of work may differ from India. The method adopted in the Western countries may be one thing, because the Western countries are economically very much advanced. There is no point in going and there is nothing to start a relief activity here. Whereas these ideas, in the field of ideas, this Vedantic thought as a perennial philosophy, as a Welton Chong, or as a philosophy for life by which we can live, which can be a gate for life, that sort of thing. So that is being preached here, and Swamis who are here, they are trying to practice it in their own life and preach it simultaneously. And in India again, it is being done in a different way. And so we preach the four yogas which Swami Vivekananda placed before the world, the Jnana Yoga, the Bhakti Yoga, the Karma Yoga and the Raja Yoga, or the Patanjali's Eightfold Yoga. Jnana Yoga, you know, is the, what they call in Sanskrit, the Vichara Marga, the path of discrimination, discriminate. This is not, this is all temporary, this is all temporary. I want something higher, something permanent, something. In this way, practicing, it has to become a practice, like a Zen practice. And till a person, the mind can reach a place where it attains certainty. That is Jnana Yoga in one line I have told you, it's a big subject. Then again, the Bhakti Yoga, the path of devotion, that most people are acquainted in some way or other, but provided the devotion, the prayers are unselfish. People go to God, please cure my headache or cure my, or please let, please see that I win the lottery and so on and so forth. That Swami Vivekananda called it the shopkeeping religion. Shopkeeping religion is no religion at all. And Bhakti Yoga means that genuine devotion. In this country we hear about fearing, God-fearing. Oh, he is a very God-fearing man. That is not a very great credit. Why should we fear God? God is your own. Vedanta says you should love God, not fear God. Love God. This is the idea of the bhakta or the path of devotion. That is also a very big subject. I'm just touching upon them because these are all at the back of whatever Ramakrishna order is doing. Then there is the karma yoga, selfless action, the way of selfless action, which the Gita, for the first time in the world, it was preached by Sri Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita. Work, but without, don't be attached to the fruits of action. Work for work's sake. Treat work as worship. This idea has been emphasized by Swami Vivekananda, and therefore all the work that is going on under the aegis of the Ramakrishna order are all meant to be treated as spiritual practice. It is worship in another form. So Swami Vivekananda says in one place that don't stand on a high pedestal and throw a farthing to the poor man. Hey, poor man, take it. But come down from the pedestal and thank him that he has accepted the alms given by you. The idea is that when you help somebody, don't put yourself on a higher pedestal and don't have a patronizing attitude, but thank the poor man that he has given you an opportunity to serve him, serve God. So a new turn has been given by Swami Vivekananda for the idea of service to mankind. That is a... And then in Ramakrishna Mission, in the field of work, there are various other activities in India. The work in countryside, in the rural developmental activities. A lot of expertise has been brought into it and which is recognized by people, by government of India also. Similarly, work in many tribal areas, what you call the natives who were not approached during the period of British government. Now those areas have been penetrated slowly, but the Ramakrishna Mission also has been requested to take up some activities. In fact, in such tribal areas, schools are being run, hospitals are being run, and various other activities are going on without destroying their tribal culture. And we say the mythology of various cultures are wonderful. They have got a great meaning behind it. Without studying them, we reject them and they say this is all some superstition. Not always. Even in the North America, the Indians, whom you call the native Indians, they have also made a lot of mythology. But if you go deeper into it, you'll find great noble meanings behind it. So human beings give expression to great ideas in various ways, and in tribal communities they express it through imagination, rich imagination, which perhaps it will do a little good for modern man to have a little more imagination. So if you look at it from all points of view, the idea of the Ramakrishna Mission or the Ramakrishna Order is as the Rig Veda says, Yatra Vishvam Bhavati Ekaneedam, where the whole world becomes one family, one nest, that the whole universe becomes one family. So it is not meant, the Ramakrishna order's ideal is universal in character. It is not meant for this person or that person alone, it is meant for everybody in every part of the world, without people belonging to any religion, any caste, or any rich and poor, or educated or uneducated. But compared to the world, ours is a very small community, small organization. There is tremendous pressure on us in India and even from abroad. Please open more centers, send Swamis. In India, they say open schools here, hospitals there, because our schools, our education institutions have earned a good name, recognition from the society and from the government. So we are requested every time, and that is one of the greatest headaches for the General Secretary who is in the hot seat. So when I open the mail, that is one of the things, every day, almost every day I will get one or two letters. We have got, we will give you this much land, this much money, please send us Swami and start a school or this or that. But there is a scarcity of Swamis. So, therefore, our ideal is global, to say the least. And at the same time, we believe in the freedom of man. The democratic approach is necessary. That is why Sri Ramakrishna says that he didn't know anything about democracy. Swami Vivekananda says that my master Sri Ramakrishna knew nothing about the English. He knew there were some queer folk that have come across the sea and they are ruling over India. That is all he knew. But he lived that great life and I read its meaning. Really it is so. Another aspect of the Ramakrishna order which I should place before you is the Sharada Math and the Ramakrishna Sharada Mission, which is entirely run by nuns. There were a few dedicated women in 1953 during the centenary of Sri Sarada Devi, birth centenary of Sri Sarada Devi. This organization, a sister organization in the same pattern as the Ramakrishna Math and Ramakrishna Mission, was started by the women. Swami Vivekananda had given this idea long back, but it did not become reality till 1953-54. So on the other bank of the Ganga, very near the Dakshineshwar temple, their headquarters is situated and it is entirely run by women. I'll tell you, this is the first time in the history of the world a monastic order of women has been started and being run by women entirely without any interference from male folk, without any interference from monks. Because you may say, what about Christianity? Can you show me anywhere that a nun could become the bishop? No. It's not allowed. Recently, I think something is happening. But otherwise, for 2000 years, no, neither under the Vatican or any Eastern Christianity, I don't think anybody, any woman could come to the top. And their monastic order, was fully controlled by the bishop and the authorities of the church. In Buddhism also, the women didn't have total freedom. They were guided by the bhikshus at the top. It was the first time in the history of the world, it may be a small organization, I think they have around 300 women monastics, but no interference from us. They have to run it themselves. They are highly educated, many of them. They collect the money, they get the buildings constructed. They have one small center in Australia. I think they are going to open a center elsewhere also in course of time, I'm sure. In India itself, they are working in different places. Of course, they are a bit cautious, you know. In a conservative society, it takes time to do it. And in the West, there is so much talk about women's lib and all that. I believe that women's liberation comes when women can work independently, not by imitating men. So that is something modern in the Ramakrishna order, because they belong to the same ideals, The same ideals are motivating them. This is another. And apart from that, that there are many institutions in India which are being guided by these ideals, where monks are not there, but the devotees run the organization. Even here it is so. In Kansas City, there is a Vedanta Society which is not run by any monks, but then a close connection with St. Louis Swamiji here, Swami Chaitanananda. Still, even before Chaitanananda came, that had come into existence. Similarly, in many other parts of even Australia and Africa, there are societies which are being run by devotees. They want a Swami, of course, but not yet. We have not been able to send a Swami yet in those places, to those continents. And again, even in United States, I know there is in Florida, St. Petersburg, there is a group, a Vedanta Society. And there is in Canada, Vancouver, there is another. These are all run by devotees, mind you. So these are all a sort of extensions of the work of the Ramakrishna Order. So when you look at it, it is a global movement. 100 years, I think, is too short a period to assess an organization like this, which is functioning with some great eternal principles, with some abiding values, eternal values, to guide the organization. In as much as we can give a practical shape to these ideas, the Vedantic idea of this universal idea of the Atman and Brahman, is the same Atman. As the Upanishads say, Eko Deva Sarvabhuteshu Guda Sarvabhyapi Sarvabhutantaratma. It is the same God who is in every being. He is hidden in every heart. Sarvabhyapi is again omnipresent, is all pervading. Sarvabhutantaratma is the innermost self of everybody. No discrimination. You need not discriminate. All the discrimination arises because of the body. And the differences are all on the bodily level, physical level. Right? We have to go deep within ourselves. And one complaint, recently I was reading a book on Vedanta written by a German admirer of Vedanta. He says Vedanta has been in existence, the idea of philosophy of Vedanta has been there for more than 3,000 years or more. But to make it practical in the day-to-day life of the people at large, there is something is to be done about it. I think this is where we will have to turn our attention in future, which Swami Vivekananda very much wanted. He said that the Vedanta that is hidden in the forests and mountain caves and temples, and to the pandits or the scholars, should come out into the open, come out into the marketplace, come out into the factory and the office, and become practical. If he says, if a shoeblack thinks that is the Atman, is the Brahman, he has that eternal divine flame within himself, he would be a better shoeblack. So we need not think that becoming a Vedantin, all our other work in the world would be devalued. We need not think that. So this is, broadly speaking, these are the ideals for which the Ramakrishna Mission has been working for the last 100 years, or a little more than 100 years. But as I said, we have a long way to go, miles to go. But I'm sure if the Vedanta is universal, if it has a message for humanity at large, its time is still in the future. We all come into the world, perhaps in the longest big book of history, we write one chapter and pass on. And we'll pass on. But the ideal will continue. And the ideal will get enlarged and spread out. As now you find the great religions of Christianity, Islam, Buddhism. Buddhism had spread to all parts of Asia. Once upon a time, it was from India. And now, the idea of Vedanta, which can be the common base for practically all religions. And other religions can contribute a lot. Christianity, Islam, the brotherhood in Islam, the ethics of Christianity, the wonderful ideas of Buddhism on meditation, etc. Many things. It's all with the Vedantic background it can be done. Some years back in Calcutta, one of the Christian institutions, an Anglican institution, had invited me for a dinner and some discussion. Nowadays a lot of interfaith meetings go on. Then one father, most probably from Belgium or France, and he asked me, "Swami, we find the cosmology of the Bible, the Genesis cosmology, is not really applicable to, and people don't take it seriously in the light of modern science. And what can be done about it?" And I said, "If Christianity is based on the Vedic cosmology, there will be no problem." Because Vedic cosmology is more scientific than the Genesis cosmology. So, of course, I don't think he liked the reply. But he didn't say anything. But I'm remembering that. So I think that without any prejudices or any bias, there are so many good things in every religion. And if you have a workable philosophy as the basis, on that we can build up a great edifice of universal religion. This is what Swami Vivekananda believed in. He said, world is still waiting for a great civilization to come. A civilization which will have the best in the Occident and the Orient, which will be brought together in such a way that the whole world will have a great civilization which has not been seen in history this far, till now. Let us hope such a day would dawn on this world. So thank you very much.
As I told you, that Swami is the right person to speak on the subject, Ramakrishna movement. He gave all the informations, problems, future. So we are really grateful to Swami to share his knowledge and wisdom to us in this evening. Thank you. Good night.